Viewer discretion is advised.
Like, it's a little weird the way they handle a lot of WCW stuff, especially during the era when they were competitors.
Yeah, they did. It is very weird, especially how they treated Sting. It was like a big slap in his face, man. And now they gave him the whole, they enshrined him in the Hall of Fame. But he never really had a chance to wrestle for the WWE. He got hurt.
Yeah, it's true.
He had to retire.
They made a big deal out of him coming back, too, and everything. Yeah,
they really did, man. He never really got a chance to get off the ground.
Nope. That's the problem, though, is I think they're relying a little bit too much on, like, as cool as it would have been to see Sting get in there and wrestle and stuff, they're relying a little bit too much on that old talent. And that's kind of the problem where they're at, I think, in general, because, you know, they don't really have any up-and-comers that I think they really can promote too much.
Yeah, man, and they don't really have a heel. I was talking to Julian about it before. There's no real fucking heel right now.
Right.
There's no villain that can really hold court. It's fucking sad, bro.
You know, it's true. You know, I mean, as much as I love Triple H, the fact that they still got to pull him out there, like, I mean, he works, you know? He definitely does.
He does.
He puts the work in.
An animal, bro. The guy's an animal.
Can he touch his side? Can he put his hands to his sides yet?
No,
right?
No. No, it's just getting bigger. It's just getting worse. He's going to have his arms up soon. He's going to be up in the yes position.
He's going to be straight out.
Soon. That's it.
He can't do suck it no more. He can't. He tries. He's just like, I can't make that X. It's not possible.
Speaking of villains, though, so Negan, we finally seen him.
Segways.
What a fucking entrance.
It's hard, you know what I mean?
Yo, Negan is a bastard, bro. And I love him.
Yeah.
That toothy smile that he has, oh my god. He's the most handsome, ugly, evil motherfucker ever.
It's good to finally see him, though, the comedian. Yeah. Comedian from Watch Dogs. Watch Dogs, I'm over here. I just played Watch Dogs recently. Watchmen.
Watch guys.
Yeah. Speaking of Watch Dogs, you should check out the co-op thing. One day, Steve, we should check that out. It's pretty fun.
Yeah.
I've been playing it with Rex recently, so.
I'm down.
Yeah. But, Negan.
Oh, God.
I mean, that speech, let's just get right into it. Well, this is Day After Dead, the final episode for The Walking Dead, episode 8. And, the season finale. And I'm Fun Known. I'm here with Jay and Acidassa.
What's up? I'm Acid Dazzle.
And Negan, because I can't get him out of my mind. He's like embedded in my brain, and I'm like having flashbacks. I'm scared still. My hands are shaking.
But I don't know. Like they had this build up, and he gives this epic speech, and we don't see it.
It was a little anticlimactic. Right. It was.
I think that's my major issue I had with it. It was he's a fantastic Negan. Like, I think he really sold it, and it was so really well done, like everything up until that point. And then just for the sake of like networking stunt, you just pull the camera back, and that shot just didn't look good in general anyway. It looked like a Sega CD FMV.
Well, with the red paint.
Night Trap?
I mean, the red drip.
Yeah, it looked like Night Trap or some like Mad Dog McCree shit. Like, I was like, this just looks bad. With the blood coming down, GoldenEye style.
Yeah,
it was a clever. It was a clever attempt at a point of view, at a perspective, though.
I thought the audio was on point.
I think so. I think honestly, though, like if you started season 7 with that, I think that would have been better than them doing it the other way around, as they appear to be doing it.
Yeah.
Of not telling you who it is now, because it's a needless cliffhanger. They've spent so much time building up to this moment, and to just kind of like. Instead rely on speculation over the next few months that we won't really have anyway, because when is it that we heard that Jeffrey Dean Morgan was going to be Negan? Like, we found that out way
before the season even started. Yeah,
so I mean, before the season comes out, we're going to know who's dead, so it makes it even more anticlimactic, because it's like, well, you didn't show it, but then like 2 months from now I'm going to hear like casting spoiler that says like, oh, it was Glenn, you know? Like, I mean, it's really, it kind of kills it, and it seems like they want to. You know, they spent a lot of time after it. Like, I don't know if any of you all watched the Talking Dead for this specific episode. I know you haven't watched it for other ones.
No, I didn't. Yeah, they didn't check it out.
But they spent a lot of time, like, kind of, like, justifying it and saying, like, well, this is the end of this story arc, and next season is going to be, like, the ramifications of that person getting killed. And it's like, well, but then like, that doesn't really fit in terms of, like, you still showing it, because it doesn't really end that story. Like, they're really talking a lot about, like, it being the humility of Rick and talking about how it's supposed to be showing him getting taken down a few pegs, but then at the same time, you don't get the build-up. You get all the build-up, but none of the payoff. You don't get to feel, like, you know, devastated or anything. And what you end up getting is a situation where 6 months from now, or even 2 months, if you... somehow, if you avoid casting spoilers and come October, you watch the first episode, the only thing you're going to really feel is relief that it wasn't this character that for the last 6 months you've been dreading it being.
Wait, you know? So to be clear, you're saying the casting spoilers as in what?
I originally thought
you were talking about Negan, but you said Glenn. So
right, well, I just used him out of nowhere. Pull it up. You know, yeah. I'm not saying anything happened, though, like, you know, whatever. I mean, this is a scene, like, that's blatantly from the comics, so there's no way of telling who the hell it is, even if you were to use that.
So you're saying, like, casting spoilers and who's not going to be there anymore on the cast list.
Right, because, you know, I'll tell you something that happened for this specific season, if you want me to tell you the truth, with the whole Glenn thing, actually,
tell us the
and
truth.
The whole dumpster shit.
Give us the whole truth and nothing but the
we
truth.
We give you the whole truth, son.
You can't handle the truth!
In this moment, I guess facts matter? Or is this just speculation?
Well, facts don't matter, but this will be a fact.
You know,
I'm gonna give
you
know,
facts. Cool? Hold on, sorry. You know what would be cool? Like, if we had, like a sound box. Like, you can't handle the truth. Press a button, and, like, Jack Nicholson, you can't handle the truth. Right there, that'd be cool.
I'll record you with these sound bits.
I'll do it.
That's it. I think we just got the drop. That's it.
God. I want 10% more, though.
We're still evolving. Always evolving.
You just got 10% less. Continue. We're going good there. I want to hear more.
But in the first half, when it was supposed to be that Glenn died, right?
Mm-hmm.
It never really played to me because the scene never looked like it was like he was getting killed because it the way it was shot and everything. But on top of that, there was a picture that went around when Jesus was cast because it was a big deal that Jesus was around. It was like, here's your first look at live action Jesus. And in that shot, Glenn was there. So I never was convinced that Glenn was dead because they never had the shot with, there was never a scene where Glenn and Jesus were in the same spot at the same time, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, like, I'm guessing, like, there's nothing happened, they haven't done filming yet, but I can all but guarantee you that it'll be a hard thing to avoid, because, like, you know, even if we take that out of account, all of us knew that, you know, Jeffrey Dean Morgan was going to be Negan, and not only that, we knew that he was going to only go show up in the last episode. We knew that because of casting.
Yeah,
you know? And I think that going into October, it will kind of be a minor miracle if somehow we go into that episode and we don't know who's dead. Because
from the casting list, for sure.
Right. You know, like, there'll be people that weren't seen on set. There'll be, like, you know, it'll end up being another situation where they've cast some Kingdom dude or something like that, and they'll show a picture of it. And then you'd be like, well, I guess Rick is alive because Rick's in the screenshot. Well, you know what I mean? Like, it ruins the impact, because the fact of the matter is now is that instead of seeing it from the show, chances are higher that you're going to end up getting it ruined for you beforehand.
Well, good thing I never read or look at anything ever. That's probably a good thing, then, is what you're telling me.
Yeah. I guess. I mean, it depends.
We're probably in the minority with that, though. Honestly, yeah. Everybody who watches the shows, they're watching what's going on with the network. They're seeing the commercials, the Talking Dead. The more invested
right,
in that.
Right,
but I
think that a lot of people, like, I don't know. I think it's a different situation because it's such a weird cliffhanger to leave on. And I honestly feel like a lot of people probably, after watching this, were like, that's bullshit, and they looked up who does Negan kill, probably saw the comics. I think that's probably what they ended up doing. I think more people probably, like, saw what happened in the comics in this particular instance in this, because people don't really respond too well to that sort of a cliffhanger. And, I mean, you have some people that are, like, slowing down the audio and trying to, like, isolate sounds and
the
stuff.
Scream,
and, like,
yeah.
Speculate.
Yeah, yep.
But at the end of the day, though, like, we're not people that go to, like, websites for spoilers or anything crazy like that. But, you know, it just happens. You know, like, it's news. Like, you know, I don't think any of us were looking to see who got cast as this Negan character. And yet, we found out before the season started. And I think that it's a little bit, like, I don't know. I don't see us being too different from a wide margin of the general audience. Like, I just feel like a lot of people are going to get it ruined for them.
Yeah, people got big mouths. Like, I already know what happened. I already know what happened in Batman versus Superman. That shit sucks. Some kid just told me the other day, just spewed it out of his mouth.
But you know what the crazy thing with that is?
Crazy.
Is that, despite us saying this, Steve is someone who wasn't spoiled by Batman vs. Superman, which is absolutely
right. But that's a different story, though.
Which is a minority, of course. I know.
Right, but that's also, like, you know, that was those are trailers we saw it the day it came out. Like there were different things. Like I bet that if we didn't see it release day, it would it, like as time goes on, it becomes tougher. You know what I mean? And it's something where those as are like, well, if you don't actively seek it, it's a little bit different. A movie is, I think, different than something like I'm legitimately I can go right now into a thread on like a TV forum and I can look at a whole bunch of threads for another thing. And all of a sudden, like, you know, just the way that casting goes, most people don't consider casting spoilers. It's just like I can look on things now and you know, it's not really anyone putting like there are spoiler specific threads. Like it's basically like saying, you know, not to basically take it to another TV show, but Game of Thrones. Did everyone
the
watch
Red
season
Wedding
five?
And then
the,
yeah.
Wedding.
Well, I was like, thinking that. I mean, all the build up to the Red Wedding, that would be like, what if the Red Wedding, they just left that on a cliffhanger and didn't show what they showed?
Right.
That's what
or,
happened
like,
here.
Honestly, just an even better comparison is everyone saw season five?
Oh, yeah.
Game and of Thrones, knows what happened to Jon Snow?
Yes.
Yep.
Right. But so Jon Snow, if you watch just the end of the season, is where he's at, right?
Mm-hmm.
But because no one cares about casting spoilers, you might have a sense of where Jon Snow stands now. It might be a little bit different than where he was at in season five. You know what I mean?
Well, yeah, no, for sure. I mean, that's just how it works with these things.
Wait, quick question about that. Did anybody notice how his eyes went like, or was it me just having like some kind of weird
that
moment?
Already. We
his
frame
eyes
by
went
frame
golden. What the hell was that?
Nothing.
I saw
they
that.
Were
They were like golden.
They did.
Maybe it was just like a fire in his eye from the in the moment. I don't know. But
this is
they
nonsense.
Look golden. I'm telling you, it's not
we
nonsense.
We stopped it. We've looked at
it's
it
not
already.
Nonsense. It was magic in the moment. It was magic in the moment. I saw this.
Damn it.
This happened.
You know nothing.
This happened.
JJJJ.
It happened. You know nothing.
But
they know.
But
there's
I mean,
someone
like,
that knows what I'm saying right now. Someone.
There definitely is. I bet the actor knows. He has
yes.
some idea.
God bless you, Jon Snow.
But you know, well, like.
Hold
like,
on!
Yeah, I can't wait for
but
that.
People know like whether or not Jon Snow is dead. People know whether or not Stannis is dead. Like it's just from simple fact of like the actor didn't come back, or the actor did come back, or like just like, you know, like that's something that easily gets out, and it's not something you have to look for. It's just something that happens, and that's on a different scale than I think of. Like you can easily avoid something like that's a little bit harder to avoid because more people are a little bit more brazen and open to talking about it and making a big deal about those sort of things in comparison to like those crazy people that are flying drones over sets and like taking videos and shit. Like you can easily skip that. Like you don't have to seek that out. But like,
I don't know. I think they're both equally, I mean, to make the, I don't even know why we're doing comparisons because I think they're both equally spoilerific. Cause like, there's no way you're going to not go, go into Civil War knowing that Spider-Man is in that movie. Everybody knows that, you know?
Right.
So, like,
yeah.
It's
Wait,
really on the same. I think it's on similar
movie?
Levels.
Oh, yeah.
That's
I mean,
what it is. I mean, there's,
yeah,
it's,
no,
there's
for sure.
Certain.
Not the way that John Cena!
Oh, I introduced him to go back to wrestling for a quick second. I introduced him to John Cena's memes.
Nice.
Oh, that was great. That was
very nice.
But, yeah, they speculate on who Negan offed. I mean, probably the safe bet would just be Aaron.
Yeah, I'm just gonna go on the record and say I hate that we're gonna speculate on it. I mean, I guess it's part. It's
but
we
have
do.
To. I guess
I have a
know?
Good speculation and why it's a good theory as well. Can I say it?
Is
it?
Oh, yeah, sure.
I think it was Abraham because if you notice that when they caught that shot to the top of their head, the only person I feel that could take that shot and be kneeling upright. Would be a big man like Abraham.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Everybody else would just have their head crushed and they go straight down. I feel like Abraham would be able to withstand at least for a couple more seconds and have, you know, have a little more left in him just to sit upright and kind of go down like a like
they,
a broken face man.
Because you know they specifically
man.
Played that out with Abraham.
Yeah. I feel as though it could be anyone. Because the writers haven't written it yet.
They haven't decided yet.
Yep.
So they're going to fill it out?
They're really dropping the ball on this one.
I think so.
So
think
is this similar to what happened with Glenn with the dumpster? Or you think that was set in stone, that he was coming
but
back?
That's
or?
What makes it worse, I think. Is
no, for sure. Absolutely.
You have this cliffhanger right after that other bullshit cliffhanger. And then it turns out Glenn didn't die. And they have this other like fake out almost, and even Daryl. Like at this point, this season, you have two kind of cliffhanger endings, or like things that are supposed to be major character deaths, and then they are kind of like, well, no, not really. And that like all it does really is ruin the suspense for this because at the same time, it's like, well, would they kill Glenn? after all that dumpster bullshit.
Well, Carol too. They played with her.
Yeah, but I mean, in this specific instance with the 10 or 11 characters that are there, because like it seemed like this entire episode was kind of giving you reasons to think, well, this character is going to die, or maybe this or now this character has a reason for not dying. And like when they kind of like show you Daryl even showing up at the end, it's like, well, he doesn't show up the whole episode. Last episode, he got shot. And it's like, well, would they end on the previous episode having him die in, or like maybe making you think that he died and then like they kill him the next episode? Same thing with Glenn, is like, would they waste four episodes on maybe making you think he dies and then kill him at the end of the season? Like, it's just kind of like, when you think about it in that context, like, all those do is undermine what they must have thought was going to be their, like, major event. It's the finale, you know?
Yeah.
So all those things kind of, like, come into play, and, like, it really affects the way you look at these things. If you didn't have the whole Glenn dumpster shit, if you didn't have, like, the whole blood splatter after Daryl gets shot, and then he comes in, you got a shawl over him, so you don't even get, like, a sense of, like, what damage was done
to him. Yeah, where'd he get shot, man? What happened with that?
Who the hell knows? You'll find out next season, maybe. I don't know. Come back. Unless he's dead.
Just in case you were deciding to never watch the show again.
Well, they show Daryl.
These are answers that you will be seeking.
Well, unless he's dead, right? Unless Negan got him, but
oh my God. You know, like,
I think Daryl would have went down with a shot to the head like that. He had nothing left. He was like on his deathbed already. So that's part of my theory as well.
I hear you. I think the only reason why like I can't say anything about it is just because like I'm so positive that they don't have an idea of who it is that died. So like I think that like I can say like, oh man, like the way he swung the bat, he came from a certain angle, and like it's like there's all these like breakdowns that we can do, but at the end of the day I think none of it matters because it's all red herrings to like make us talk about this stuff when the reality of the situation is they have no clue. They're gonna figure it out like based upon like contracts, who demands more money, and like that's like there's gonna be real life things that I think are gonna actually affect
business decisions that are gonna affect the design of the show.
Here we go again with this,
right?
Carol leaving just because they needed a reason to make the saviors come around, like what the
right.
hell?
Right, you know, I thought that was kind of I was a bit surprised that they didn't have like the little end of episode thing. Like, I thought we were going to get something at least on the kingdom this episode. Yeah. Like, you know how last season they had, like, the meeting of Negan's people and everything?
And like, then that one season with Morgan.
Right. You know, I thought they were going to do something like this and nothing. Nothing at all.
Well, the kingdom, man, they look like some real knights in shining armor, those guys, huh? Look real. Handsome guys, too, huh? Wow. God bless them.
Oh, yeah. Can't wait for that.
I can't wait for them. I'm all about the chivalry, bro. Straight up, those guys are some serious dudes for sure.
You think anyone has a mace?
Oh, definitely. You better have a mace.
I hope so. That'd
there's
be
a
cool.
barbed wire bat. There's got to be a mace.
They got sure. horses. They can joust. These
Kenpo sticks.
True.
All that shit, yo.
And you got Morgan there with his ninja skills. So he's gonna be introducing them because he came up and he snuck up on that dude on the horse. I don't know how he pulled that one off, but he did it. That guy must be deaf. He didn't hear the horse coming.
Well, he was dying, so he was focused on Carol shooting
I guess.
The pea shooter, you know?
But like a horse is loud though.
It's very loud, unless he de-hoofed it.
Maybe he took time out. He's like, I know something's gonna happen, so let me just
clear this now. This noise. I must clear the noise. Okay. He is Morgan, man. That's gonna be Morgan's his resting place though, the kingdom. He's actually he's gonna be able to just chill now in the kingdom with his wenches.
Hey, why not?
And his kingdom, right? Underlings, you know? He's gonna train kids now. That's it.
It'll be interesting to find out though how the kingdom plays into all this with Negan's group and Rick's group.
I was really hoping to hear like 100 hooves just coming out of nowhere, man. I was hoping and praying for that, just to see a barrage of horses just coming
that
and
nuts.
Just
imagine that
and just annihilating the whole situation, seeing Savior scatter everywhere and swords and
yeah, I was about to say in the background, oh, people coming out of the woods with
that would have been
with
epic,
swords
man.
And armor.
That would have been some epic
big helmets
shit
on.
Right there. Great introduction. That would have been a perfect time to do it. Hi, Negan. Hello, Kingdom. You know, Like, this is, these are the new factions that are warring. Here we go. This is the world's bigger. The world's bigger, but not that big because we don't know who's coming back yet next year.
We might
close the doors to the kingdom still.
You know, the kingdom may gonna really be it because, like, we can't get enough good actors in or something.
Yeah.
Or we're going to have to put so much, like, Morgan demands so much money, and he's just like, well, fuck it. He's Negan now, so we can't not give him a bunch of money.
Oh, man. He's handsome, though. Oh, he's handsome, man.
He really does well in the role. He sold it fantastic. But at the same time, too, like, the entire thing that happened in my head once he shows up during that last 10 minutes was also kind of like, the rest of this episode was a waste. Because it's primarily them getting railroaded into this major thing that they stupidly fall for in, like, 10 different ways. And then they fall into this trap. And then the last 10 minutes are the only thing that matter. But at the same time, it's the same situation as, like, the beginning of this season. Because if you remember, like, the way the last episode ended of the A-half was with, like, the whole mom thing.
Mom.
And, like, that whole thing that got resolved within the first 10 minutes of this season's premiere. And it's going to be, I think, the same situation when you come back from 7. And I'm like, well, why not just put those 10 minutes in this episode and cut out some of the meandering bullshit you had in this one? And just, like, make that, like, wouldn't it be a little bit more impactful if you saw the person get killed and then, like, had it be like, all right, Negan pieces out and he leaves them to, like, deal with what happened. And then, like, now you have the whole next season being about the quote-unquote ramifications of what occurred. You know what I mean? Instead of delaying it. Like, it just seems like it's really poor. It was such, I don't know.
No, I think this episode was done well, though, because the way they had them on a specific path, like, you're going to go down, you're going to travel where we want you to travel. Basically, you're going to make the decisions that we want to make you. So the thing that they were playing out, they were personifying exactly what they wanted them to do. You're going to make, there's only one decision for you to make here. You can't go down this road. You can't make a left. You can't circle back around because we want you to make this one decision. And the way they had nowhere to go, every road that they went down, saviors. They went another way, saviors. Because you're going to make our decision. It's eventually going to come to where we want you to go. Just like the guy said, you're going to get to where you're going, and where you're going is where we want you to go. That was beautifully done. Just the way the tension was building, the patience was so slow and so gripping that it built an anxiety the whole time. I was, like, nervous for Rick, and then it all just came to a head when you see Rick, like, he couldn't hold his head straight at the end. Like, he had this glaze over his face, like, I am powerless. There's nothing I can do in this situation. My son is here. The woman that I love is here. My family is here. We're surrounded. It sounds like there's 1,000 saviors. All you hear is echoing of... and just these little lights focusing on this little circle, this little ring of death that's being formed around you, that there was the anxiety was just overwhelming, man. I really was shaking. As soon as I heard his name again, Negan, I started shaking again. I think they did it so well, man. There was nowhere to go the whole time, the whole episode. Nowhere to go. Everywhere you went, saviors. Everywhere you went, saviors. It was beautiful. I think it was beautifully done, man. I really do. I really think it was cool, man.
No, that's good to hear. I mean, I think it's interesting to hear how much of an effect it had on you because, like, you know, like I said, I just felt like, I know this is a 90-minute episode, and it just felt like by the third time that they got caught in a different trap, I'm kind of like, I get it. Like, I mean, like, you didn't need to do it another 5 times.
I get it. All right, they're fucking everywhere, man. Shit.
It's like, I'm picking up what you're putting down. And, like, you kind of see, like, the characters slowly get it, too, where they're like, that was a different group. Oh, man, like, it takes a long time to set up, like, this roadblock of zombies. And I'm like, yeah, yep. I don't need, like, Abraham coming to that realization now, and now it's going to be Maggie. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't need all the characters slowly realizing how fucked they are. It's like, maybe we probably should have realized that all together at the same time and, like, maybe moved on a little bit and progressed to kind of end things a little bit more succinctly. Like I said, it's just interesting, I think, to know that it had such an effect on you because by the time that I got up to it, I'm like, man, 10 minutes, like, this is going to be a tight fit. And then it ends the way it ends. And, like, all I was sitting there was kind of like, fuck, that was a waste of 90 minutes. like, did it really need to be a 90-minute episode? Like, in comparison, that could have been 60 minutes. Like, it just seems like they had this extra half hour to use and squandered.
I think it was just to build anxiety, you know, just to drag it out a little more. Drag. I think it was all intentional, just to drag it out. Drag it out. What's going to happen? Is there a way out? There's no fucking way out. There's no road that you can go down. We want you going this way. This is what's going to happen. It was already predetermined.
But is that not something you felt before, though, in the previous episodes already? That anxiety that was building, that these guys, they're coming from every direction, that something's going to happen to our group, and that they feel that they're a little too confident for the situation that they're going into?
Oh, yeah, I kind of said that before, but it, like I said, it was personified in this episode, the way the man was thinking, and his hand was on the board, on the chess piece, and like just pushing the little matchbox car along, pushing it along.
Rick's acting, though, is definitely on point, though.
Oh God.
Yeah, it was all really well acted, I think, honestly. Yeah. I definitely, like, the least thing I take issue with. It's just, I think, the writing and the overarching concept behind, like, dragging out. Like, it's just when I think about now, because what I've been doing since the episode kind of aired is I've just been, like, thinking in retrospect of the season. And I think it just started off so strong. And then I think it just kind of, like, that latter half, I think, was so weak in comparison. And I think that that's primarily because they really wanted to drag things out to end in a specific part, and then they drop the ball on that. Like, it just seems so, I don't know, like, just from that strong start to like what happens somewhere in the middle that they decided that this is how it has to end. I don't know, it's weird. It really leaves like a weird taste in my mouth that I don't really know how to consider it. It's just, like, you know, it just, and, like, just to see, like, how easily everyone has just, like, started ripping audio and started speculating. And just, like, the Talking Dead immediately after was like, who got it? And it was like, I get what you're doing. And it just seems so skeevy to me in a way. I can't, for lack of a better word. You know, it's so manipulative, you know?
Yeah, honestly, I would have preferred the discussions around how it impacted us if we would have saw who got offed. Those right. discussions for me would have been more interesting, you know, to draw the comparison again to the Red Wedding of Game of Thrones. After that episode, just remember back to how everybody felt. Like, you couldn't believe what was going on in that moment. Yeah, right. The amount of sadness, you had hope
right.
up until that point. And then right there, you had the cold realization that, you know what, maybe this is a world that everything is fucked. You know, there's no happiness in this world. We got to make with what we got, and that's it.
Exactly, you know, and that's, like, you know, why I think it really undermines what they were trying to really portray here, because it's this scene, and you built Rick up to be, like, the hubris that they had, and all this that, like, they thought that they had it. Like, even in this episode, he's like, tell him I got a deal for him. Like, it never, like, slowed down. He was always, like, acting like the big dude, and, like, he was like, yeah, I'm going to fuck these dudes up. And then, like, that realization was like, no, we're pretty fucked. Like, we're, like, outnumbered severely, and we're fucked. And, like, you end up leading up to it, and then, like, you just kind of pull back once you kind of get to that feeling of devastation. Because, like I said beforehand, like, as it stands now, no one's really considering anything else. They're really just considering, like, the death of who died, whatever. And when it turns out to be a character that is not their favorite character, people are going to feel relief. They're not going to feel devastation at, like, the events that happen. They're not going to feel, like, powerless. They're not going to get that feeling. What they're going to be is like, man, I'm just glad it's not Daryl. You know what I mean? Like, it's it's true, you know? Like, yeah, that's how they're going to feel. They're going to feel happy about it. And, like, that sucks, because that's not how you should feel. This is supposed to be, like, a big...
It feels more like a psychological experiment where they've learned from previous seasons, like with Glenn with the dumpster, where they had their finger on the trigger to the off them, to see where the pulse was of the audience, whether people to just end watching Walking Dead, or now their discussion is, all right, you know, like you said, that relief. So, like, maybe they think it's Glenn. If it's not Glenn, then they'll sigh, then all right, I'll power through it. Or if it is Glenn, maybe they've already had all the rationalizations in their head, and then they're mentally drained, where it's like, all right, so it is Glenn. At least it's not Rick and Carl or something, you know? So right. maybe it just seems all science, you know, instead basically, of passion. Yeah. You know?
Like, that's why, like, the whole dumpster thing, like, as much as they probably planned it as, like, a pilot to get a sense of like where the fans stand, which really undermines the whole thing. Because if it does turn out to be Glenn or whatever, like then it really puts a whole dour aspect on the whole season. Because then like why waste all this time on this with him feeling that way? And you like, you know, like all this aspect of time like on him surviving because of the whole dumpster, and then all of a sudden like he dies 4 episodes later. Or you know what I mean? Like it kind of like I get what they were doing in terms of testing those waters to see like how people would feel if Glenn were to actually die, if that's the case, or like what people would do if they were to kill off someone so major, like how people would react. But mm-hmm. then like if you're gonna actually kill someone major like 4 episodes from now and then kind of leave it ambiguous, then it works against that pilot, you know? It doesn't work out in the same way. Like whatever you were testing for, like because you did it in such quick succession, you've kind of undermined the validity of that test, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, it's... that's why it's like I thought it was interesting to hear that, like, you know, I really want to hear about how you guys all felt after it was done, because when it was all done, like, I just felt disappointment, you know? Damn. I didn't feel any devastation or, like, curiosity about, like, oh, man, what does this mean for the group? I was kind of like, man... That's what they did.
It's a situation of we knew from the beginning, we knew the end. So the end, we know what the end is, that someone's dead, but their right. delivery of the end wasn't what I feel was satisfying enough. Or not, it doesn't lead to something as interesting to discuss as what the alternative would have been.
Right. So like on the Talking Dead, they at the end of the episode, they had this thing where Chris Hardwick basically goes up to him. It's like getting a lot of like tweets with like, you know, caps lock, and people don't seem too happy about like the stunts that was pulled. And they, because they had Kirkman and Nicotero on there, and like they also had Morgan and Reedus. So they had like, you know, a bunch of people on there, full on couch. And
that sounds like he a crowded this- couch.
Yeah,
anybody who's sitting on whose lap?
Daryl was basically on, or Reedus was basically on Morgan's.
Oh, that's cute.
They were liking it. It was a good time.
That's cute.
But the way they set it up was like, you know, there's all these people that were upset, and they were talking about the basically storytelling element of a cliffhanger, and they were making these really weird comparisons to Lost. And it was really strange to me because, like, the one that they were specifically making was, like, you know, at the end of the first season of Lost, there's the hatch. And they were making this whole allusion to being, like, you know, no one was really making, or, like, it was more interesting was the aspect that they were talking about when you had the intrigue of what was the hatch and who was in the hatch and why is there a hatch on an island and, like, the significance of the hatch. And they were saying that they were more or less trying to bring something like that to this season and the show. But my thing is that it's like you can't really make that comparison because the hatch actually is an intriguing mystery with all these different possibilities. When you think about like the fact that someone died this season, it's a very simple question. It's just someone died by a baseball bat. Who was it? And that's it. You know what I mean? Like you can't really try to make that analogy between a show like Lost, which, you know, actually had like a build up towards this throughout the whole season and meaningful changes that can come from something like a hatch in comparison to like a character that is dead. You know, it's not really the same exact thing. So I just thought that it was very strange that they really kind of kept making that comparison. They were very adamant about it. And it seems like that's their defense that they're going with as to why they like made this whole cliffhanger. And I don't know. Like, I didn't really like, what do you think about that? Like, do you feel like a character death is something that can be as big as something that actually is like a wider mystery? Do you feel like that's a good cliffhanger to leave on in comparison? Or do you feel like that's a fair comparison, I guess?
Me personally, although I can understand a comparison, but I don't have any emotional attachment to Lost. I've never watched it in full.
Mm-hmm.
But to the question of ending on a mystery, it doesn't lead to anything that's more interesting to discuss than what it would have been if we would have had to deal with our emotions in the moment of who out of these characters that we love got their end. I think that would have been far more interesting, more engaging for us to move forward with and to see what people felt about it instead of playing the game of well, it could be this guy or it could be that guy. You know, it's right now it's just unknown. It's just, I don't know. I don't really find this speculation game that we've played before. You know, the same spinning wheel. Too exciting.
Here's how they should have ended the episode. Picture the beginning of Gladiator when when the barbarians are, you hear them, they're like, "Hoo-ah! Ha! Hoo-ah! Ha!" Right? So now you're hearing a slow build up. We'll bring back the horse hooves. A slow build up of horse hooves coming up. But there's a lot of them. And then you see one torch as you're hearing, "Hoo-ah! Ha!" One torch. And on the other side, there's another torch. And then on the other side, there's another torch. And on the other side, there's another torch. And then all of a sudden, one knight appears on a horse. And then on the other side, another knight appears on a horse. And then shit, you could even put Morgan on a horse. So now we know it's a friendly situation. And you can maybe bring Carol. You don't have to bring Carol because, you know, whatever. Carol's hurt. She could be wherever she is.
But that the knights are part of Negan's group?
No, but maybe a part of Negan's group, but maybe not a part of Negan's group, because now you have Negan.
Quite, like, what the fuck?
Well, like, what the fuck is going on here?
Yeah.
But now, are the knights here representing us? Are we saved now? Or is this, like, is this really our end? Because we're in this little situation. We're now so small that we're just onlookers upon this greater world that's about to clash in front of us.
Well, in this scenario, would anybody have been offed, or would the knights have came before Negan did his thing?
They would have came right as Negan would have done his thing, and they're so important and they're so powerful that they would have stopped him from doing his thing, and they would have been they would have had so much importance in the situation that he would have had to stop doing his thing, because now he's faced with something even bigger, and that makes us even smaller.
Well, I mean, they're on horses and they have guns, so they're not really a threat, though.
But wait, they're on horses. But you know what, though? Honestly, like, what's a couple bullets in comparison? You got to figure these guys, they're all ready. They would all be ready to die. So that first wave of horses can just, of course, a few are gonna die. Everybody knows when you're going into battle that we might die. So that first wave, take a hit, but most people are going to get trampled by horses. So they're not really scared, and that's what makes them even badder in this situation, because they know we might die, but we got fucking 100 horses behind us, and we're not all going to die. That's the way they should have ended the episode.
With a fire lit in the sky?
A fire in the sky, torches, fucking screams.
That's how, you know what? That's how, going by the track record, though, maybe that's how the next season is going to end. We're not even going to see the knights at all next half season.
Oh, God. No.
They're going to do, like, maybe one shot of Carol and Morgan.
Good night.
And then we're just going to be, you know, them building
up. I think
Carol's
going to
be pregnant.
First episode of season 7 is like entirely focused on the kingdom with Carol and Morgan, and then like maybe we get to see who died. Like, we don't see Rick's group until season 2 because like they drag it on for as long until episode 2.
See Rick's group,
like, they drag it on for as long as they can.
You know? I mean, they've done it all, so I mean, I guess everything is part of his track record at this point.
They're gonna throw him in the bathroom, throw him in the box, throw Rick's group in the box where Daryl came from, put him back in the box, throw him in the bathroom.
I think the smart thing and the way it should have ended is like, think about how this ends, right? They said they were only going to kill one person and they want them to work for us. So realistically, they kill someone, they let that marinate, they bounce. And they're like, give us half your shit and next time we're going to fuck you up. And like, I think literally the way that they should have ended this episode is kill someone, leave on that note with like Rick and like the whole group looking dejected and like dealing with what just happened with like the dead body next to them on the floor. Yeah. And then that's it. Cause I guarantee you that if they don't try to pull any of that bullshit, like I just said, with like focusing on Kingdom and Carol and Morgan in the beginning of the episode, that's how they're going to end. That's what they're going to do before the intro season 7, episode 1. And I'm just going to sit there, and I guarantee you that when we do this recording for that episode, I'll be like, why didn't they just put that 10 minutes at the end of the last episode? Because that's exactly the way that I felt about the first half of this episode, of this season, coming off of last season. Because if they had given that last 10 minutes to that to the finale of part A, you would have had a much stronger finale. And it just ends up, like, undermining it. And I guarantee you that that's what it's going to be. It's going to be like, all right, so they're going to leave. You're going to see, like, Negan's truck driving off in the distance and everyone, like, crying over the person that's dead. And then you're going to hear, wah, 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 and you're going to be like, oh, man.
Man. You know, and you're going to be thinking, what a waste of my first 10 minutes, bro. Holy shit, man. You could have done this shit last year, bro.
Right. It just started right off from that, you know?
Wasted my fucking time. Fuck you, Kirkman. You already know how you're gonna end this shit, and you keep pulling this shit.
Well, maybe he doesn't, though, based on
based on previous theories, right? He doesn't know what he wants to do. This fucking
it's possible. You
get
know,
your shit
it's...
together, Kirkman. Shit, man.
I mean, Kirkman has an idea of who he wants to kill because he's done it already in the comics. So the question remains to be seen if it's the same person as someone else.
Yeah,
I guess.
So I'm blaming Hardwick. He's in charge of all the Twitters and all the social media. He's like, no, dude, you got to do it this way, man. You got to fucking do it this way, bro. He's got all Kirkman all twisted and fucked up right now and shit, man. Just let me do what the fuck I got to do, Hardwick. Get out of my ear. Get out of my head.
I think Kirkman wrote this episode, though, actually. So I wouldn't be shocked to find, like, you know,
as opposed to Hardwick?
Either way, either you want to make it different from the comic.
I thought it was Hardwick. It wasn't Hardwick?
Nah, it's
somebody give that man another show. Keep him busy.
Hardwick shadow writes all the episodes.
He's the ghostwriter.
He's a ghostwriter.
Like he puts them under Robert Kirkman and Greg Nicotero. But it's real, we all know it's Hardwick. He sits there in his Nerdist Industries and he's just like, what bullshit can I come up with next?
It's really C.H. Kirkman, you know? C.H. Robert.
Yeah. That's gonna be real. That's
the JR. All right, there, JR. Tolkien. C.H. Robert. Get the fuck out of here, man. Cut the shit. Give me a fucking ending, bro. Cut the shit, man. Mm. You know I'm just trying to be fucking positive, bro. I'm trying to find something good in the situation, and I'm sorry, bro.
The strengths were there. I mean, the acting was on point, you know? I mean, Negan's delivery was great.
His smile, I can't stop with his fucking smile. It was just like the Grinch. He just kept going. It's like more teeth and more teeth and more teeth. It was fucking great, man.
I mean, did the tall dude look like a more unraveled Negan? You know?
Who?
The dude we saw first with his
mouth. Travis from Grand Theft Auto?
Yeah, I was going to say the that mouth, too. Yeah. I was going to say that too. That was Travis. That was straight up Travis.
That was the hype man. The hype man.
Yep. That was like, that's basically like this whole episode is going to be just hype man Travis. Just all ready for Negan, and then that's what it was. You know?
Oh man!
Fucking Heyman over there, huh? Brock Lesnar, Negan, saviors.
So let's talk about for a bit. Like, who would you want to get killed then? Do you want Aaron? Does everybody want Aaron? So it's easiest.
Just give it to me easy, man. Nah, at this point, it's got to be someone heavy, man. I'm sorry to say, it's got to be a second in command, bro. Can't be Rick, because then I won't be doing the show anymore.
But who do you want?
Who do I want?
Well, I mean, Steve, if you know first, you can think about it, Jay.
Michonne. I mean, it's tough to say. Michonne could be cool.
Yeah, I think that would have the most impact on Rick.
Mm-hmm.
I think it'd have the most impact on Rick.
Honestly, though, I think so much of that crew could have such an impact on Rick because so many of them have been around with him for so long. Like, I mean, obviously he's in relations with Michonne.
Yeah, and that'll teach him a fucking lesson. Don't fall in love, bro. There's no time for that shit. You have your child. You have your children. Focus on that. That shit is over for you, bro. That shit is over. Get the fucking shit together. Build your fucking tribe. Cut the shit, man.
Build a wall.
Build. Hunker down.
Gotta build a wall. Build a life.
Wait, no, that one's over. That one's out. That one's out of the question.
Damn, it's a couple seasons past. It's
yeah, bro. He's tired. I'm tired, son. I'm tired. Still one of the greatest moments in the whole fucking series for me.
Yeah, I like Rick's speeches.
Yeah, man. Sitting in the window of the barn. I'm tired, mm-hmm. son. My daddy was better at this than I am. I really don't have any profound words. I'm tired, son. Take the gun. Take it. Mm-hmm. Take it.
So who would you want, Steve? Who would you want?
It's tough to say. I think it has to be either Daryl or Glenn, if I'm being honest, because I think that those are the only characters that can have such a huge impact. You know? I mean, and this is totally removed from anything related to anything else, but like I think that those are such fan favorite characters that I think that like they would have to be the ones to go because they've been around so long. And I mean, honestly, like I'm trying to think of like what would have an impact on the story, right? And Glenn, I think, is probably one of the big characters that I think would have the most impact because you have to take into account then what would Maggie do? She would be like shit, she would
girl.
Be fucking...
She's struggling right now.
It's tough.
You're looking like shit.
But like, how would she take that? You know? And then, like, especially if she loses the child.
Yeah.
Rick would take that hard too because he's been with Glenn since the beginning. You know, I think everyone would take that to be a pretty big deal. Like in comparison to characters like Aaron, who like just seem to be there for the purpose of like being the easy way out. Yeah. You know, because like if you're gonna kill anyone,
too, bro. This is an equal opportunity. This is an equal opportunity apocalypse. Okay. All right. Every status is represented in the apocalypse. It has to be. Mm-hmm. All right. So leave Aaron alone.
I think, though, knowing where some of these things go, Aaron, like, and that's the thing I think, too, is when I think about the storylines that they've set up for these characters and some of the storylines that I kind of know they're going to adapt, truthfully, you can safely kill Aaron because I think there are other characters that can take his place.
Yeah.
You know, I think that would just be too easy, though. Basically, it honestly would. And that's why it would be so cheap if, like, after all this bullshit, it ends up being Aaron that gets killed.
Yeah.
And I think similarly Eugene would be too because like I think it's a really good like they've kind of it would be another situation like Denise I think where they've been building this character up pretty well actually and like they've given now Eugene kind of things to do and I think that like the idea of making bullets and like being that munitions person especially now within the context of like we're gonna pretty much go to fucking war like we have to or like we need to be prepared. You know, like, you kind of need to have Eugene fill that role. And I think it'd be interesting to see him fill that role, you know? I think to kind of remove him, you know, they had him give the recipe of the bullets to Rick, but I'm like, it's really not the same. Like, it would kind of suck.
That was just a set of death flag.
Pretty much. The whole episode was death flags, honestly. Between, like, Abraham and Sasha.
Yeah, Abraham and Sasha saying, we could do that. Could you do that? Glenn and Maggie did. What did he say? Oh, man.
Bitch quick in the pancakes.
Bitch balls, what did he say? Oh, man, he said some bullshit.
He has a lot of those.
Oh, now. Bitch balls. What was he saying? That shit was funny. He's funny. God bless him.
Mm. Who do you think?
Who I want is... let's see.
This is a harsh conversation,
It
man.
Is. It
this
is harsh.
Fucking harsh, man. Who I want to die?
Damn, I mean, I probably want Carl.
Carl,
because I like Carl. I like his growth, you know. Even though there's still some things that he was still annoying this season. It was this season, right? This half season with the Enid thing that he was in the with Diana. That was in the first episode with the zombie. That was it. So I mean, just seeing that, see how Rick would deal with that, I think would be interesting for me. But
I think it would be interesting to see what happens if they killed Rick. I mean, if we're talking about interesting things.
No.
Because, yeah, I mean, that guy they introduced, maybe the knight, the one who went to shake Morgan's hand, he has a good appearance to him, you know? Maybe he'll have some sort of strong presence in the future episodes.
No.
Could be. I just think it would be a ballsy move to kill off the ostensibly main character.
Yeah, that would be...
It would be fucking bold.
Yeah.
That would be a big fucking thing to do.
Hardwick wouldn't do it, though. He's too scared. He doesn't have the balls for that. He doesn't have the balls for
that
shit.
He doesn't have the fortitude.
The moxie. He doesn't have it.
You know, Daryl has a show coming out, Norman Reedus, in May. Where
ride,
it's, he's
yeah,
like,
ride with. Yeah, some shit.
Yep.
And wasn't he in talks with Kojima about this?
He's been in talks with Kojima for a minute, man. I don't know if that's ever going to be a thing.
Is it going to be Solid Snake?
No. Kojima is that's a whole web thing. He's been fired from Metal Gear Solid.
I picture him.
Konami doesn't make games anymore.
Konami.
They make pachinko machines and ways to make money.
Pachinko.
Yes, they do. But you know that I think that would be a. You know, normally another actor doesn't have a show, right?
Well, Rick had something going on for a bit.
With Strike Back, he did. Yeah. He did. He had it was like a spinoff of Strike Back.
But it didn't go anywhere, did it?
No, it didn't. I mean, the show was it was good, but it was just like a one season thing. Like it was like a backstory to or side story to one of the characters on Strike Back.
How long ago was that? Was it like during the beginning of the show?
It was
a couple seasons ago, I think.
It was a few seasons ago. Yeah, it was a few seasons ago. I think. It was around the time where there it was a question if Rick was gonna make it or not. I think it was. It might have been around.
Finger
the time.
On the pulse. You know what I mean.
It was around the time when I think Rick was laid up on the couch. Remember?
Oh, with Carl. Before Clear.
Yeah, it was. It was around that time. So Rick might have been on his way out, but then you know he renewed his contract. Got that money.
He was like, "I don't want $2 million. I don't want $200 million. I'll take $100 million. It's okay.
That's all right. Peanuts.
Yeah, it's all good. Whatever.
Ain't honey roasted, but they're still peanuts.
Give me $100 million, but I want more residuals. Give me 10% on the back end. Man. Let's go.
Them Todd McFarlane toys. You know what I'm saying? Sell them shits.
It's all about the merchandise. That's where the real money comes in.
The merch.
Yeah.
Put me front and center. I want that Rick figure with the guns and the opposable arms.
No Rick, though. Sorry. It's not going to happen. I can't have that happen to my life.
It'd be ballsy to kill off Maggie, too. Killing off a pregnant woman.
A woman, yes. It would be. I said Michonne also, man. That would be some shit. Because the person I was watching with, my wife. My wife. She was like, no, he can't kill a girl. I'm thinking that shit would be pretty fucking badass if he killed a girl, man. Man, if like he winked at her, blew her a kiss, and then smashed her face. That would have been pretty crazy, man. That would have been pretty sick. But then it could have been Aaron. Oh, shit, gotta edit that. Talking about killing a girl? Damn, sorry.
Well, what's the problem with that?
I don't know. I'm just saying.
What? There's fast and loose, baby. Fast and loose. There's nothing wrong with that. You know what's funny, though, about the equal opportunity thing that you brought up with Aaron earlier? That was actually, I know you don't watch it. Well, Steve, you watch it. But remember Supergirl, the crossover?
That was an awesome crossover, by the way.
It was. I love the chemistry to go on a quick tangent with Supergirl and The Flash. It was charming, you know? But
that's a sweet couple.
When Kara was introducing Flash to Ms. Grant, but I forgot how it was exactly, but when Ms. Grant was like, oh, we have a nice little cast here, a diverse cast here, like a CW show.
Right, like a CW show.
Yeah, that was so funny. Because we had like a black dude, we had a white girl, we had a white guy, and like, well, I guess really that was it though. That wasn't actually very diverse at all.
Well, it's diverse in so much as you have white dude, white girl, geeky white dude, and then like black dude, which is like what you kind of would get in a CW show.
Where's the Spanish
show dude?
And then like T-Dog, there's never a fucking Spanish guy. I don't want to hear that shit, man.
Not on CW.
There was vatos. Like, you know, actually, the meaning was that shit.
100 has a pretty diverse crew, so you get some Spanish dudes in that.
You know, and the vatos too. Was that was longer in the comics, wasn't that the vatos?
No, vatos weren't in it at all.
Oh really? Oh, I thought that
was a show. Look at that thing. Shit. So like, bro, they never went and found those vatos dudes. Which I think could have been an interesting thing to actually like explore earlier on, but they were never real in the comics. Y'all want to go into the comic zone and talk about?
Yeah, because
like,
you brought up.
You are now entering the comic zone.
So if you guys don't want to know about spoilers, you should come back in a couple minutes, I guess.
Yeah, we'll put it in the timestamp or something. Maybe we'll put it in the YouTube description.
I mean, we've talked about it openly in previous episodes anyway, what you're probably going to say.
That's true.
With who Negan offed, because we know who it was in the comics, right?
Exactly, yeah. You know, I'm just going to say it right there. You know, just it happens in the comics doesn't mean it's going to happen in the show, but it's Glenn that dies.
Yeah.
You know, Glenn gets it. And they actually do, yeah, I want to bring it up because we were talking about a whole equal opportunity thing. And when Negan comes in, basically goes up to each person, gives a reason for not killing them. And he's like, oh, I can't kill the girl. I can't kill the black guy. That would be racist. And like he goes up to like each person and like he gives like basically an explanation as to why he doesn't kill him. And then he goes up to
that's
it.
That's funny. I can't kill the black guy.
Pretty much. He's like,
that's funny. What
do people think if I killed the black guy? People,
the only black guy in the afterlife, right? In the apocalypse. Gotta give him a chance to respawn, man. So, brother, pound that. You better fucking pound that. You better pound that, brother.
And then they kind of deal, like, throughout the rest of it when they're dealing with Negan, he brings up a lot. He's like, just because I killed the Asian American guy, like, he was the least representative, or he was, like, the least, like, problematic for me to kill, basically. He's like, what are you saying? He's like, you know, all this, because I had to kill this one dude. It's like, you know, and he keeps bringing it up. It's a pretty constant thing.
Yeah, it's funny.
But to keep it in the comic zone, and again, let me know if like this goes a little bit too further, like just because this is talking about potential like things that may happen in terms of storylines.
Hold on, yeah, you know what? I just figured it out. It's gonna be Glenn. Like that, they were testing, like we were saying, they were testing the waters with how he died. With the dumpster, and now it's like, damn, that's all we painted ourselves into a corner. Now it kind of has to be Glenn in order for it to not feel like. Like said before, mm-hmm. a relief. Oh my god! Like it has to be Glenn now.
It has to be something big.
It has to be Glenn.
You know, it's also the impact that killing Glenn has is because they also set it up a little bit early in the season when they were dealing with the Hilltop and Rick, for whatever reason, decides to have Maggie deal with what was his name, Gregory.
Greg, Douglas? Yeah, the Hilltop guy, yeah.
Yeah, Douglas. Gregory, right?
No, it was Gregory.
Greg Doug.
Doug, one of them, Greg Doug. So she's the one that deals with Greg Doug, and she like makes a deal with him and all of this stuff, and it seems very arbitrary at the time, but like because Glenn dies, she doesn't really take it too well, and like she ends up actually becoming like the leader of Hilltop, and I feel like that you really can't have that be the thing that happens if Glenn's death isn't the thing that kind of motivates her. And leads to other events, and then she becomes the Hilltop leader. Like, she needs to have that impetus to split, and I suppose they could give that to someone else, but it seems like they've kind of laid the groundwork already for that to be Maggie, that I think that it would be a little bit surprising for it to not have that happen.
Yeah, they're going to the Hilltop anyway. The doctor's there, the OB's there, and it's peaceful there, and she's not reminded of Glenn everywhere she looks.
Right. Just being all pissed off, too, because, like, when they come back, like, after this altercation, they go to Hilltop, and they have a conversation with Gregory, and they're fucking tight, because they're like, you mean to tell us that, like, you let us go into this situation, but you must have known full well how large of an army they had. So, like, you let us basically go on the suicide mission to, like, go fucking die, you know? And, like, they're pissed. And, like, that starts its own events, you know? So, like, I can't see, like, this is basically what I foresee happening in the first episode is because, like, they're talking so much about, like, ramifications of things that happen and whatnot. I feel like, you know, it's going to be a lot of, like, tension between Hilltop and, like, the Alexandria crew in terms of, like, we're going to be your hitmen, and then you don't give us enough information to really be prepared for the situation and, like, the things that come out of that, you know? Wow. The more and more I think about it, like, you know, there's no necessarily correlation between the two, and I'm legitimately positive that they haven't figured out exactly who it is they want to kill, but I really don't see how it cannot be Glenn. You know, he's the only one that I think really
you
fits.
You know something? If it is Alexandrians, what if you look back in history, who were the Alexandrians? Alexander. And what happened? What happened to really bring Alexander into power? His father died. Ooh. They killed the father. So now who has a father? Carl has a father.
So
now in order for Carl to come to power, simplicity says who has to die? Rick has to die.
And it would be cool. That would be cool.
God, that would make so much sense.
That would be cool. It would be a bold thing for them to do to kill off a main character like that.
And I think that actually might have just like maybe like help me come to terms with the fact that Rick could possibly die, and maybe he, dare I say it, should die in order for Alexandria, the Alexandrian way of life, to expand. Because, you know, what did Alexander want to do? He didn't want, he wanted the whole world, but he wanted to bring the whole world together. And that's what Alexandria stands for. And now they have their knights. They have their way of expansion, the horses to ride out. Oh my God, it could be something I could possibly deal with now.
I think that Negan, though, is like the only thing that I can think is that, like,
he's the Persian Negan army, bro.
It would be an interesting thing, but I think that Negan's smart enough to also know that he'd essentially be killing him and making him a martyr. I think he would know that that's kind of what he would be doing to kill Rick.
Yeah.
I also feel like that's why he kind of got that throwaway line in the episode of, like, if anyone moves, cut the boys out, give it to his father. So, like, kind of let you know, like, hey, Rick and Carl are safe.
Yeah, they're not going anywhere.
Yeah, like, I feel like that's what it got.
Okay, well, that's good, because I could come to terms with it, but I'm not ready for Rick to die yet.
It would be bold, man. It would be a big thing.
But I'm not ready for it.
To stay in the comic zone for a second, too, is Dwight actually ends up becoming a pretty major character. Daryl doesn't exist in the comics. He was a show-only character. And it's one of those things where, as the comics were going on, like, they actually had a lead-up to this episode, to this chapter, like the 100th chapter.
To cut you off real quick, do we want to talk future in the comics, or did we agree last week? Because I remember, didn't we have a discussion something about just staying in parallels with the comics instead of it's talking parallel. About future?
It's there right where we are.
Yeah. Well, I guess so. I don't know. I think it's parallel because Daryl never existed, so that's why I'm saying he might be on the block because Dwight is Daryl. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Oh, that's interesting. So
they actually introduced him. Finkel is
Einhorn.
I did forget that, though, that Daryl didn't exist at all in the comics, huh?
He was never a character, so they had this lead up to this chapter. It was something called, like, Something to Fear. Mm-hmm. And they started showing off, like, a character with a crossbow. And then that character was Dwight. So, like, you know, like, to be honest, like, Dwight, like, I can foresee him taking over easily the role of Daryl were he to go away, you know, because he would still be like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know if I'm articulating it correctly.
I don't know,
like,
I hate Dwight.
Daryl never existed. Yeah, they can give it to face. Dwight, and Dwight would do what he would normally have done, you know?
I'm gonna punch his face.
Because they've made Dwight a character now. Like, it's not like he isn't. So, like, I don't know. Like, they can easily have something still. Like, they can give a storyline to Daryl and Dwight, sure, but I have to imagine that, like, because they're from the same archetype, at some point, like, having two of those same characters.
What are they similar in that they shoot a bow and arrow? I mean, crossbow?
I mean, Dwight basically, when he was introduced, more or less is Daryl, you know, and that's kind of the role that he ends up taking, is like the right hand man of Rick. You know, he ends up becoming Daryl. You know, he ends up essentially being what Daryl is in the show. So, like, if they're going to take those storylines, they have to basically give them to one of those characters. I can't foresee them giving them to both, you know?
Yeah, I don't think the actor they casted for Dwight would make a good sidekick to Rick compared to Daryl.
He doesn't have a strong enough fortitude, I think, either. I don't think so either.
It's hard to say because Daryl is Norman Reedus. He's a great actor. I don't know if we've really seen Dwight enough other than, like, cowering and...
He's a bitch. I want to punch his face.
You know?
I want to fucking rock bottom his ass. Give him the people's elbow in the face.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want to do to him. Stone Cold stun his ass. Fucking spray beer in his fucking mouth.
Let him know.
Bitch.
But that's also, like, rope. Why I was... you know, that those are things that kind of play into, like, what I think is going to happen. But at this end of the day, I still think those are two of the most major characters they have in the show. And I think that they would have a huge impact. Daryl alone, you know, like, that's... People would cry if Daryl died, you know?
Yeah.
Well, how cool is that, though, that he didn't even really exist in the comic and he's so important to everybody now, you know? Mm-hmm. That's pretty cool, you know? That's pretty cool.
He was so big that they had to put him into the comic. Like, they basically, like, that's why they made this analog. Because he's, like, he was such a big character. People loved Daryl, and, like, they were like, all right. So, people, like, thought, like, when you started showing the panels, because they did, like, this whole, like, run-up thing where it was, like, Something to Fear, like I said. and you started seeing like characters' weapons, and like one of them was like, you know, an axe, and one of them was like a crossbow, and then everyone was like, oh shit, are they going to introduce Daryl into the comics? Like, is this going to be like an instance where they like actually take the TV show as the source material for the comics? Ended up being this Dwight character, but like, you know, it was a really interesting build, I think, for the time. They actually did a lot of really leading up to episode chapter 100, which is the whole Negan thing, you know, to kind of get people hyped. And the whole thing is like a very iconic moment from the comics, you know, and it's just they've did such a good job adapting everything else. For them to kind of drop the ball is just, you know, to harp on, it's disappointing. But, you know, we've talked about that already.
Yeah. Damn. I mean, it's where, I mean, we covered a lot, you know?
Yeah.
I'm trying to lead into Fear, but before that, try to see if there's anything else we can talk about The Walking Dead, you know? Because really, it's kind of, and to say though, it's a little disappointing because now that's where the discussion ends, you know? We don't discuss now how we feel that X character is dead. You know, that's not a discussion we're having right now, which I feel like would, again, I mean, we discussed it before, but again, that's such a big deal. You know, I guess that can't be understated enough. It can't be stated enough that that impact it could have had finding out in that moment who died.
Yeah, they really put a fucking damper on our episode today, didn't they? Like, they gave us no ending that we can't even end the episode. So, you know, everybody just get comfortable.
Fucking wait till next goddamn season to see what the hell happens.
Later. Wait till four episodes from now. One of us is just like, yo, I was just working around on fucking Google, and all of a sudden someone was like, oh man, you know, Norman Reedus isn't on set anymore, and they've shot like three episodes, and it's like, well, I guess Norman, like, you know, I'm sure that we'll end up knowing way beforehand, and it just fucks the whole thing up.
Don't you say anything, you hear me? Keep that shit to yourself, bro.
You'll find out.
No, I won't. No, I won't, man.
Well, how'd you find out about Jeffrey Dean Morgan being cast as the as Negan?
You?
Yeah, we told
me.
You
with the Watchmen?
Yes.
Yeah, I think you knew beforehand.
It was you.
No.
I mean, we can go back to the tapes to see if it was a surprise.
Play the tapes. But I think you knew.
Play the tapes.
I'm the one that mentioned that he doesn't show up to the last 10 minutes. I don't think you knew that, but I think you knew he was going to be the comedian. You were like,
I did. I did. I kind of stumbled on it. I did. I was fucking around reading some shit.
Tell you. I thought I was the one who. I don't know. Whatever.
No. I was fucking around reading some shit, and I was like, oh, what? I just like rolled with it because I like the character.
Saw him at all in the. You know. It's not really a spoiler. That's something that's not really a spoiler because we didn't see him, his character at all in the episode anyway. That's like, oh, maybe this guy's Negan.
I honestly feel like casting stuff isn't a spoiler because, like, it's just this actor's
nobody, gonna work. Yeah, no, I don't think we would disagree with you.
But it really was you. It really was you, though, Asadasa. It was you. You fucked the whole shit up for me, bro. Okay, go to the videotape, bro. Go to the footage. You'll see.
Let me ruin some more things. What can I ruin for you?
Go to the soundboard, man. It was you. Just shit.
Batman dies.
You're morose bullshit, bro.
They're riding him out of DC Universe.
God forbid. Holy shit. Imagine that.
He's calling to Marvel, and that's it.
They better add a fucking I and a K to DC if they're going to do that shit, bro. Might as well be dick comics.
Any of you guys watch At Midnight?
No.
I saw a few episodes. It's pretty funny.
I think it's pretty good. There's, you know, it depends, I think, on who's on. But there was an episode with Robert Kirkman. And I remember, actually, when this happened. It was, like, a couple months ago. And they had, like, one of those hashtag things or whatever. And it's, like, you know, spoil The Walking Dead. And, like, they were supposed to make up fake spoilers. And one of the things that Kirkman says is, there's this character that's going to show up called Negan. And he's got a bat called Lucille. And he kills Glenn. And I was like... I can't believe you fucking said that on TV. And you just hear everyone just kind of like gasp and go, oh, because like there were people that were like, that knew like, you know, the significance of him just kind of saying that sort of thing.
Holy shit. That's just not funny, man. How is that fucking funny? Like, what the hell's wrong with that guy?
he was just like, you know, he just kind of does it, and like just like it was shit. It was funny because it was him. I think there was Maggie's actress, and I can't remember who the other person was on it. Oh, and I just their faces that they made when they were like, oh shit! Like I was like it just sounded real, and it was a funny thing.
You want to know something too? Now I'm gonna do a little spoiling, man. I saw a fucking Inside the Actor Studio with the cast of Walking Dead. Should I continue what I'm going to say? You mind?
Do I mind?
Yeah.
I think I might. Okay, you know what I would mind.
Yeah. Oh, man, I can't do it then.
Close your ears. I
want
to hear.
You want? I mean, it's just purely speculation, of course. You know?
Well, go ahead.
Maggie was crying. She cried, and she was the only one that cried on the show. And she was like, I said I wouldn't cry. And you know, she seems like she's pretty in touch with her feelings, you know, but she was the only one that cried on this show.
There's a lot of stuff out there though about like what's Rick's actor's name? Like he's like, I showed up late that day to shoot because I was so like taken aback by what happened. And then like Norman Reedus is like saying like how tough it was. Like there was a lot of build up and like news cycle bullshit where everyone was talking about how incredibly tough this season finale was gonna be. So like I don't know, I'm not particularly like shocked to hear that someone was crying. I don't know if that means one thing or another. I just think that that's like ways to kind of hype up it is. I mean, like I said, truthfully, I really don't think that like they've shot the scene. I don't think anyone knows. I don't think that the actors know, because I don't think the writers know. I think that's going to be something that like is still yet to be determined. So, you know, we can take like all this stuff and we can speculate based on it, and like we can use it to like validate our opinions months from now when it turns out to be that whatever character that Aaron dies, you know. But the truth of the matter is that I'm 99.9% positive that they have not figured out yet who it is going to die.
Nah, man. They should just pull the trigger.
So, now what with Fear? They're playing into it next week? It goes right into it?
Right into it. I saw something about Flight 462 today.
Yep.
And, like, the fate of Flight 462.
Was that a web... The little web episodes?
Yeah, the things that they were showing in the commercials. Yeah.
I saw a couple of those. They seemed pretty good.
Yeah,
they were fucking garbage.
It was dumb. You're the one who doesn't like character development, though, so what the hell?
I mean, they're only like, what? Like 30 seconds long? I liked it.
Yeah, they basically took an episode and stretched it out over 30 seconds. Yeah, it all took place on a fucking plane.
It was dragged out a little bit. They did try to take a piece of gum and split it between like four people. They did.
But you want to talk about it? Do you know who lives?
No, I don't. I don't know anything about it. I just know that Nick saw it in the sky, and that's like... I saw the commercial that they had today during the episode. That's all I know.
Right, that was like the end of the episode, I think, though.
Yeah, it was. It was the end of the episode.
Yeah. But, like, they went out. And that's the other thing. Like, you know, it's... Again, it's not like I'm seeking this shit out, but it's casting stuff. So, like, they went out last week and had, like, a big PR blast on, like, this character joins the fucking... cast because of blah 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 from Fear 462, and I was like, oh, all right, cool, I guess. I don't know, it's like I don't really have any connection to this character either, so like they tried to make a big deal out of it, and I was like,
so where do you guys hope they go with Fear? How do you hope they open it up? You think we find out right into what they're going into with the boat, with the dude? Or,
the smoothest talker?
This guy better get some fucking more pills. That's what he better do. Nick better get some more fucking junk. He's going to be in a world of shit.
You think he's going to be struggling with that now? Or you think he's clear with it? Or you think it won't be as much of a hindrance to him anymore? That they'll play it up?
I think that'll be like... Is like they get onto shore and he has like maybe he'll see a breadcrumb and be like, shit, do I make the bad decision right now?
Because it kind of seemed like he was clear-headed at the end of it, you know, where his mother, remember this conversation we talked about, where his mother what he told his mother, this is the hell he's been living.
Yeah, like, this is, I've been here already. Like, welcome to this world. Maybe, so. But I don't know, man. I feel like that's going to be always hanging over his head. You know, it's always going to be hanging over his head. And the more bad shit that happens, the more he might want an out. So I don't think it ever really.
When do you think they'll then build his character? This season? Or you think they'll continue with that same thing with his character?
Well, and
I guess it depends also if they go straight. If they go straight into it, then yeah, he's still struggling with it.
In terms of like hope for humanity, or in terms of like reality.
What do you mean?
Like, do you want me to have hope for his character, or you want me to like be honest?
No, what do you think they're gonna
he's not gonna ever get off the jump, bro, and eventually he might just OD and kill himself. That's like real world talk right there.
Damn. So you think it's gonna be a constant theme that he needs to find pills in the environment?
Until it isn't anymore, man. That's just the reality of it. Yeah. It really is. Sad to say.
How about you, Steve? What do you think?
I mean, I guess if we talk about the show, I mean, realistically, you can only... Well, truth of the matter is, I was about to say, well, realistically, how long can you drag out the he needs his pills thing? But then you have to keep in mind who it is we're talking about, and that answer could be 6 seasons, so...
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And it also depends. You think they'll do a time jump at all, or they'll go straight into where they left off?
I think they'll jump into where they left off. I don't know. I feel like Fear the Walking Dead, like we talked about this before, I think, where I stand with it, where it had a lot of potential, and then I think they really dropped the ball with it pretty hard.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm hoping this season can kind of realign and fix itself. Like, it's in such a weird place, because as much as I like characters like, you know, the what was his name, Victor, the barber or whatever,
mm-hmm.
Like they fit, they feel more like characters that would be more at home in The Walking Dead as opposed to Fear the Walking Dead. Like, it's this weird thing where this is supposed to be like so immediate after the zombie like apocalypse started, and it's so weird to have these people have this mentality of like, oh man, whatever, fucking kill everyone, go for it, like, yeah, you know,
like,
what I mean,
like, they were already in the shit.
Like they were down like,
yeah, the, like, oh, this shit,
I'm like, yo, let's do it, my family, fuck them.
Hold on, let me go to my fucking apocalypse closet. I got everything we need for this shit, bro. I've been prepared.
Yep. They had their fucking bag and everything.
The bug out kit
their
ready.
Bug out bag. Yep. What are those people called that like set up for the apocalypse and shit?
Fearmongers.
I mean, that family, I think, handled, because like in the show, they there were other people that weren't handling as fast as the family we had. So, I mean, right. I think they handled that aspect of it kind of well.
I don't know. I think they tried to have their cake and eat it, too. Because you had certain characters that, like you said, kind of, like, wavered on it and didn't adapt to it quickly. And it's this weird thing because...
Trav, you know who you are.
But as a viewer, right? You don't, like, this is the beginning of the episode, and, like, you have more information than they have. So you have these characters that are, like, struggling with it, and they're trying to, like, save these other people and being like, well, maybe we can save them. And what you end up having because of these characters are these weird retreads of, like, earlier storylines from The Walking Dead. But then you had, like, it seems like to alleviate that so that they can try to do something new and to, like, speed it up so it's not, like, basically... going over the same material, in a sense, is they add these characters that have like post-apocalyptic points of view. So like they have them too early, so you end up with this weird situation where it's like, you know, people shouldn't be feeling the way they are, they should maybe be dealing with this whole thing a little bit more. And like that's why I feel like it was such a fuck up for them to skip over like the whole actual outbreak. Because what you ended up with was you're in LA and then up here's time skip and all of a sudden LA's empty and everyone's chilling in a fucking fenced in neighborhood that's being run by the government.
Yeah, that's definitely what I would have wanted more from the show, is showing the process of what society would, the gradual breakdown of society, instead of having it as quick as it was. But right, as far as like the believability of that one family, I feel, because like say for right now, if the zombie apocalypse was continuing, if the same events were happening in our neighborhood that happened in their neighborhood, I'll tell you right now, my family would be responding the same. Well, would be faster to react than what Nick's family would. You know what I mean?
But which family? Like, are you talking about the barber or Nick's family?
Nick's family, I said. So, like, and then we saw their neighbors were, like, some of them are still bunkering down. So
they're having a right. party.
Yeah. I feel the like most people would be up. A little bit like that. Like, I feel like that's the realistic angle. But I think, like, in terms of compelling story, like, is that interesting?
No, they should have for sure fleshed it out, I feel. Especially right. in contrast to what we're getting with The Walking Dead, how it's just, they're already in it. Right. It's far more interesting than to see, like, I was so curious to see how the whole thing started. And, all right, they're going to have one town. Then how it affects that one town, but then seeing other towns affected by it.
Right.
But, I mean, who knows? Maybe we'll still get that. Maybe they'll head up to another town it's now slowly affecting, or I don't know.
This that actually would be an interesting aspect to cover, though. One of the things that I was talking about last week that I said I'd mention more this week,
mm-hmm.
where we were talking about, like, the walkers and, like, whether or not they're decaying and stuff,
mm-hmm.
right? Obviously, like, I thought about it actually now because, like, in Fear the Walking Dead, like, they're harder to kill, you know? And they actually have to put a lot of effort into them because they're fresher. And then in comparison to where they are now in The Walking Dead, like, they can kill them easily with, like, sticks and shit, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I remember last week I was talking about, when I brought it up, I was mentioning that, like, you know, actually, because I think something, there was an article that I read or whatever this week that was talking about how 2 years have passed in the show. You know,
in Fear?
No, in regular Walking Dead.
Oh, the regular, okay. So right. wait, 2 years have passed since the outbreak?
No, not like since episode one of The Walking Dead.
Oh, okay.
And like where we stand now, season six.
Mm-hmm.
Like at least 2 years have passed. Who knows how many years have passed since the outbreak or whatever, or how much time. But like in terms of like how long we've been following Rick and crew, it's been 2 years. And it reminded me of the fact that, like, in the source, right, and if we can, whatever, Comic Zone or some shit, but, like, it's really not that big of a deal. Like, they actually kind of build up towards the fact that the zombies are actually kind of decaying. Like, they're less of a threat, you know? They're not as significant a threat because winter has kind of, like, necrotized their flesh even more, and they're just so easy to kill now. And as time progresses, they've just continued to be, like, not that big of a deal, you know? And I think it's just interesting because, like, that's something I feel like they should explore a little bit more in Fear the Walking Dead, is because, like, you have this instance in the show proper where you have, like, these things that are just nuisances for the most part, honestly. And then you have something like Fear the Walking Dead where they're still, like, flesh and, like, hard flesh. Like, they're as fresh as they're going to get, you know? I feel like that's something that I think would be an interesting thing to see them kind of like explore more, is making the zombies in and of themselves be more of a threat in comparison to other people, you know?
Yeah, and you know, that also, like, Fear, they can be the scarier show, whereas right. The Walking Dead, because Walking Dead does have its few moments where it's scary, but it's not really the core of the show, I feel. Whereas right. Fear, they, you know, it's in the title. You know, this is, you're gonna be afraid of The Walking Dead now.
You're
this
still
is
a
this
big
how
fucking
it,
problem.
This is how the problem begins.
Right. You know, and like making you actually fear the zombies, because the way they stand now in The Walking Dead, they've made a big deal of the fact that you don't really need to worry about the zombies. It's the other people you need to worry about.
Yeah.
In this one, like, the zombies can actually be like a threat, and maybe now it could be an interesting thing where perhaps you have to worry about both, because it's not just the people that you need to worry about, but like you also need to actually be really legitimately concerned about these zombies that like take some effort to kill. You know, like you can't just easily like poke a stick into their fucking head and like kill them. Like you actually have to put some effort into like stabbing them in the head, which was one of the more interesting things when
that's why you must fear The Walking Dead.
True.
Go ahead.
They had the mother, I don't remember her name, that went into the kill the principal. And, like, she was kind of, like, fighting him hard, you know?
Madison.
Maybe.
No, that's her name, definitely. Maddie. Madison.
You can tell me anything of these people's names. I couldn't tell you. I know Nick, that's it. And then the smoothest talker.
Strand.
That's all I got.
Strand is his name. Strand.
Could be.
Definitely could be. I got you, bro. I got you covered, man.
I'm gonna take it on your word. I honestly couldn't tell you.
I'm a sponge, man.
Nah! That was a little sponge, dude.
Barnacles! Brought to you in part by Nickelodeon.
Oh shit, the sponsor's getting dropped again.
Let's go. Get on board. No, actually,
I got edited out last episode. The sponsor drops.
Oh shit.
I don't think I'm editing anything this episode. I'm just throwing it up there. There's nothing really crazy that needs to be cut anyway. You know?
Good.
I don't think so.
Fear.
I mean, there's probably some silent moments.
Hey, nothing more than a few seconds, I feel. You know?
Eh, whatever.
And facts don't matter.
Nothing matters. Boo-boo. The show doesn't matter.
Well, we made it past episode 2, 3. Yes. We kept going all the way up to episode 8.
We made it
the
whole season.
It's crazy. Yes. We're going. We're powering through strong, baby.
Did it.
I mean, we're here to stay at this point. Despite, I think, waning feelings on the show.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I'm excited for Fear. There's still, you know, I can't wait to start that discussion next week. I mean, hopefully it'll, that season opener. Is it 60 minutes or is it going to be a 90-minute opener? Any word on that?
For season 7?
No, for Fear the Walking Dead.
Fear.
I think just 60.
Just a regular episode then?
Yeah, they would. I feel like I would have seen that already. 90-minute special.
Yeah.
I know that they're hyping up the fact that they're going to have the Talking Dead for the show now. I'm like, oh, great.
So, more Hardwick.
I guess Hardwick gets the yearly gig now.
more hard dick.
Pretty much.
Damn, we were going so well. I guess I'll leave that.
Oh, it's all
I like Hardwick. I like Hardwick. I think he's an all right guy. He works hard.
Yeah, I like him too, but he should stay as a host, not a ghostwriter. He's fucking shit up right now.
Very true. He's a hardworking man. He's out there. He's doing it. He's making it happen.
He works hard for his money.
I liked him on G4 back when he was on that network.
So did I.
I mean, he's basically made like a podcast empire, like the whole Nerdist thing he basically built. Like, I mean, honestly, like he's out there and he's in so many things, like on so many channels. But I mean, he's put in the work and the effort to get there. I think he gets a hard gig, a hard rap. I think.
Does he?
Yeah, a lot of people hate him. They're like, really? I fucking hate seeing him on my show, and I hate seeing him for that 2 seconds that he's on at the end of the episode. And like the amount of people that are like,
those are haters, bro. It's just because they see him everywhere. He's fucking everywhere. God bless the guy, man. He does a lot. He does work. He does a lot of shit, man.
It's true.
He doesn't sleep. He just plugs in and recharges. He doesn't sleep.
Yeah, his energy level never drops.
Never. He's great.
He's
man.
On it. He's on his game, man.
He is.
It's a lot of weird esoteric nerd shit because I think he also gets that fake nerd thing that a lot of people have for whatever reason. That's really always strange.
Yeah.
Like, if I'm going to trick anyone, why would I trick someone into thinking I'm a nerd? Like, there's definitely better things I could trick you into thinking I am. You know?
So
I mean, the nerd market is huge, though.
People I guess. Think he's a nerd? But I don't know.
Oh, man. Yeah, much better things to try to trick people into. Yeah, man.
It's like those fake gamer girl things, and it's like, yo, really?
That's the
like
comparison I was drawing in my head.
Makes sense.
Yeah, it's like a weird thing for, like, you know, you hear that kind of comparison all the time. It's like, listen, man, if a girl is going to try to trap someone, it ain't going to be your ass. You know what I mean? There's much better out there than your fucking ass sitting in front of a screen playing games all day. You know what I mean? Like, maybe it's true that they just like games too. It's possible.
Yeah. With all that cleavage.
All that cleavage, man. And that wristband that they're always wearing.
Wristband.
Man, cute. Yeah, I always see like a wristband on a gamer chick, you know what I'm saying? You know, to wipe the sweaty brow off her cleavage.
You started at your head and then you moved your hand.
Yeah, because like, what the fuck is a brow in comparison to cleavage, man? Nobody looks at the face.
Speaking of that, there's YouTube videos of chicks saying how they get ready for makeup for streams and stuff, how they pretty
up
there.
But
their cleavage,
that's totally different though, because
no, of course,
like,
I mean that's not the whole player base of female gamers, obviously.
Not even that. I mean, there's something to, like, honestly, like, you could still be a person that likes games, but like, if you're gonna be a Twitch streamer, like, fucking use all the assets you have. So like, if you know what I mean, like, that doesn't mean that you are a fake. It doesn't mean that you're a you're playing up your love of games for something else. Just means that, like, you know, you got some nice titties and that nerds are horny as fuck.
Yeah, I always said that in the context of the...
We said cleavage, bro. Cleavage. Why you gotta go titties, bro?
Well, let's edit it. You know, you got some of that clever vajaj.
It's not an edit. Whatever.
keep it clean, man.
Free the nipple.
Yep. Free the nipple.
Yo, speaking of freeing the nip, you saw my Miitomo picture?
Oh, yeah.
Hello, nope. World.
I don't think I've seen that one.
The one with the spotlight. Isn't that the one where I was like, hello, world? Or was that
I
the
actually
one
where haven't I was like, seen you that many times. I've only seen you twice, man.
This guy, man.
I got fucking right now. Let me tell you how many friends I got on this Miitomo. Let's take it Miitomo minute. I got 123 friends on Miitomo, man. What's good?
Damn, 123 friends on that.
123 friends.
This guy's a beast. I'm less than 20.
Where you at, dog? Get in there.
I ain't got none.
I'm actually a little tight that you added me on Facebook instead of in person, because that's 100 coins we could have gotten, man.
Oh, I don't know how that works. Damn, you should have let me know. These are the things that I'm trying to tell you.
Well, you know what? I'm going to let Jay know. So, Jay, go on your phone, download Miitomo, and I'm going to roll through, and I'm going to get 100 coins. Just shut up and download it. Just shut up.
I wasn't even saying anything, man. Shut up.
Shut up and download it. Shut up.
Shut up and drive. M-I-I-T-O-M-O.
M-I-I-T-O-M-O? T-O-N-Y? Top of New York?
I think this is a pretty nice spot to wrap it up. Bye. Wrap it up.
Bye.
Wrap it up.
So this was episode 8 of our Dadcast, Day After Dead, with
Before we wrap it up, I feel like it's worth mentioning that because we didn't get to a lot of our normal segments, and I think a lot of that comes from just the episode. Like, I think that this is a finale, so we kind of had a talk about that for a minute, you know, like we didn't get to talk about the weapons of the week or anything like that, but truth be told, like, I mean, this was a 90 minute episode, and that cliffhanger, like, as was brought up, kind of kills a lot of discussion that we could have had. You know?
I mean, it's true. I mean, we'll figure it as far as structuring. Well, let's talk about that for Fear of the Walking Dead to start with, that, you know, maybe that'll be the fresh start for that going into this podcast.
Yeah, I got feel a like good weapon. I got, all right, here we go. I got a good weapon. Sorry. A weapon
it's a
that
bat
they.
With,
go ahead.
It's a bat with.
No. Why? It was a weapon that they didn't have. A fucking gun turret, bro. A gun turret.
An automated gun turret.
You know what I'm saying? On top of the fucking RV. That will just wipe out everybody that was there. 50 cal. I'm sure there's 50 cals lying around somewhere that they could have
propped up.
They
had a rocket, though, actually.
That RPG.
Rocket? What happened to that shit, bro? Where was Daryl's ass in this episode, bro? What the fuck?
True. You know what, too, also? Like, straight up, why when they first ran into Trevor, did they murder his ass right then and there?
Yeah, when there was only five saviors. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. None of them had guns at that point. Like,
decision-making is the weapon of the week, bro.
But, like, murder him. You know what I mean? Like, it seems so out of character.
Yeah, so you gotta be all in or you're not in at all. Like, you're either the kingdom, like, you're off somewhere else,
well,
that
they
you
still
don't even exist, or you're all in, killing fucking everybody. You kill, survival of the fittest, kill fucking everybody. Somebody's in your way in the street, kill his ass. Now you got fucking 5 more cars. You're rolling deep, everyone's driving, mow everybody down. Cut the shit, bro.
But they still had Daryl, Michonne, Glenn.
They did. They probably
died. At the time, they didn't know that, though.
They didn't.
They didn't find that out till like, the third fucking trap that they ran into, where, like, they saw the
that is true,
dreadlock
right?
In the thing. Like, when they first ran into Trevor, their concern is basically, like, oh, shit, like, Maggie might
That's
be having a miscarriage.
That's why it's good to talk it out. I knew that, you know? Just throwing that out there. I knew
kill
it, bro.
Everybody.
Don't worry, I knew it.
Kill knew everybody. It.
Because
now
they
you
had Michonne's dreadlock and whatnot.
That maybe would have forced their hands, and then now Negan's crew is scrambling.
I mean, it would have fucked up their whole plan, right? If their whole plan was to railroad them somewhere, if at the first roadblock they were like, nah, son, and they just murdered everyone and
fuck
went to hilltop.
Fuck this. Like, I'm kill everybody. Now you're fucking hauling ass to the hilltop. The hilltop's being prepared. Now hilltop is scrambling. Now the kingdom gets the word. Horses fucking riding, bucking to the hilltop. The shit's hitting the fan faster, bro. Kill niggas, B. Kill.
You and them horses, son. You sure that your weapon ain't horses?
No, well, horses with a turret.
Horse with a turret.
A 50 caliber horse, bro.
We're walking into Turok territory.
You know what I'm saying? or a fucking Terminator or some shit, bro.
Cerebral Boar would be perfect though on the zombie Cerebral apocalypse. Cerebral
Boar.
What? Because it would latch on to only humans, you know? Because why would it latch on to a zombie? There's no brain activity. Well, minimal.
I mean, honestly, either way, it would probably be perfect because that's how you kill a zombie, headshot. So just, yo, here you go. Boom.
It's true either way, yeah.
Yeah.
Fuck, man. A turret, bro. Come on, man.
I'm with you on the turret. Let's go. Mini gun.
Shit, just fucking... That's it, bro. The whole fucking... The road's clear. Let's go. We're not worried about... We only have a third of gas left. We only have two more roads left to travel down. What the fuck, man?
Honestly, even then, like, once they realized that shit was kind of fucked up, I think they probably should have doubled back. You know? Like, all right, so obviously we're being railroaded down one specific road. So here's what we're going to do. That first road, let's go back down that road. And let's just fucking murder those dudes that were waiting there unarmed. And let's make our way to Hilltop and let's fucking do it. Because they're expecting us to not try going back. So, like, let's just do that. That's going to be our first course of action.
After the second block, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, because now the numbers are building. It's like, oh, the first one? Oh, yeah, we could still have a little balls, you know? There's not that many of them. Oh. Second one, we can maybe handle this. I don't know. You know, maybe we should go. Let's just go. Oh, shit, we ain't going fucking anywhere.
Yep, it's like, fuck that. Let's go to the second road. Let's just do it. Let's make it happen.
Let's go back to the first one. Yeah, man. Fucking shit, bro. 50 cal turret.
Yeah. Or just, you know, I'm going to go with C4 because they could have loaded the RV with C4 and my man Eugene could have made the ultimate sacrifice.
Kamikaze.
You know? Drove right into their fucking, into that crowd. Hit the switch. Hit the switch. Boom. But
while they're playing the Ace of Spades. The Ace of Spades. You know what I'm saying? Or time to play the game. Something.
Keep singing.
So I'm on the game. And are you playing? And it's a troll if you can take it. There you go, bro.
Yep.
You asked for it, and I gave it.
Keep going.
Sing the whole song. I could just
look
do
it up right now.
I could do the guitar solo. That's it. Only guitar solo. I'm like air guitar over here too. If you can see me. Go ahead. Wrap it up.
Let's do it.
Well, I guess is that where we're calling it?
That's what we're calling it. That's it. This is Day After Dead, Episode 8, Season 6, Part B.
Let them know, Ashley. That's a let them know.
Where could they find you? Where could they find you, son?
I mean, they can find us on youtube.com/IXIClub. You can find all of us on there. You can find, like, all of the club cast, the dad cast, some spoiler casts. We got so many casts
for you
to watch and listen to.
Pow!
Get in there.
Bang.
Listen to them.
Zoom.
Watch them.
Pow.
Like, follow, subscribe.
Woo.
Follow us on Twitch at twitch.tv/IXIClub.
Tell them how you're feeling, son.
On twitter.com/AcidAssa. Follow Unknown on twitter.com/Unknown.
IXI. Unknown/IXI.
Follow Jay when he leaves his house.
Follow Jay at his house. Knock on his bell. Say you want to say what's up.
Knock on the bell, though.
Don't ring it. Because that shit don't work.
Knock on it.
That shit don't work, yo.
Let me give you his number. It's 516.
555.
But that's it. We'll be back next week with Fear of the Walking Dead. We're going to talk about that.
God bless you.
We're going to drop a whole bunch of information about it on you. It's the premiere, so that should be exciting. And we also are on iTunes. Check us out on iTunes. You can look for Day After Dead.
Woo!
All of our episodes should actually be on there, so we can check that out on there. And we have an email address. What's the email address, Unknown?
It's theixiclub@gmail.com. Hit us up with comments, anything you want us to talk about, maybe a topic.
Yep.
And we'll make it happen.
Any questions you got, we can answer those. Like, I want to hear your thoughts. So if you want, like, a homework question of the day, whatever, for you to answer, tell me what you thought about the season finale
of The Walking Dead.